Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again on the GATE solution, GATE question paper solution and discussion lecture. So, in the lecture, we will cover the subjects thermodynamics, thermal engineering, gas dynamics, heat and mass transfer, and fluid mechanics. The questions from these subjects will be covered. And this is lecture number 4. So, we are going to solve the questions from the 1997 question paper. So, the first question, in radiative heat transfer, a gray surface is one, which appears gray to the eye, whose emissivity is independent of wavelength, which has reflectivity equal to 0, which appears equally bright in all directions. In radiative heat transfer, the reference surface is black surface. All the other surfaces are, they are considered as gray surfaces. All the surfaces involved in the radiation heat transfer, they are opaque. They are reflecting and absorbing, not transmitting. So, the gray surface among the four answers, the right answer is whose emissivity is independent of wavelength. Other answers are not correct. This is the appropriate answer. The wavelength of the emissivity of the gray surface is independent of the wavelength. Second question, the specific speed of the centrifugal compressor is generally higher than that of axial compressor, less than that of reciprocating compressor, independent of the type of the compressor, but depends on the size of the compressor, more than specific speed of the compressor, reciprocating compressor, but less than that of axial compressor. Centrifugal compressor is running with the very high speed. So, the correct answer is higher than that of axial compressor. So, now for reciprocating compressor, we are not calculating the parameter specific speed. So, we calculate the specific speed only for the rotary compressors, axial compressor, centrifugal compressor. Among the two compressors, centrifugal compressor, they have the higher specific speed. Which among the following is a boiler mounting? There are two main parts are classified into two, mounting and accessories in the boiler. So, mountings are essential components without which the boiler should not be operated. Accessories, they are added to improve the efficiency of the boiler. The boiler mounting in the four is blow-off cock. Blow-off cock is the boiler mounting. All the other feed pump, economizer and superheater, they are accessories. Without accessories, you can operate a boiler. You take a simple boiler. Simple boiler may not have the superheater, economizer or the feed pump. Even natural circulation boilers are available. But the blow-off cock is an essential component. So, without the boiler mounting, we should not operate the boiler. Blow-off cock is used for draining the boiler during the shutdown period. For an ideal gas, the expression T dou S by dou T at constant pressure minus T dou S by dou T at constant volume is always equal to 0 Cp by Cv R into T. The four answers are given. Here in the first term, T into dou S by dou T at constant pressure is Cp minus T into dou S by dou T at constant volume is Cv. So, this is Cp minus Cv equal to R, the Mayer equation in thermodynamics. So, the correct answer is R. A system undergoes a state change from 1 to 2 according to the second law of thermodynamics for a process to be feasible. The entropy change S2 minus S1 of the system is positive or 0, is negative or 0, is 0, can be positive, negative or 0. So, the answer we have to identify from the Clausius inequality, cyclic integral of del Q by T less than or equal to 0. So, this is what the Clausius inequality. There are three statements. First, cyclic integral of del Q by T equal to 0 when for a cycle, del Q by T is equal to 0, the cycle is reversible cycle. When del Q by T is less than 0, the cycle is irreversible and possible. And when del Q by T is greater than 0, the cycle is impossible. Now, here the question is whether the process is feasible. So the answer, so first two process, first two cycles are feasible cycle. So it is reversible cycle. It is also possible, but it is irreversible cycle. So for the question, the answer is negative or zero. So according to the second law of thermodynamics, for a process to be feasible, the entropy change S2 minus S1 of the system is negative or zero. Kaplan turbine, it is a hydraulic turbine. Kaplan turbine is a high head mixed flow turbine, low head axial flow turbine, outward flow reaction turbine, and impulse inward flow turbine. So the answer, right answer is, it is a low head axial flow turbine. Kaplan hydraulic turbine is a low head axial flow turbine. So you have a manometer. So the manometer, one limb of the manometer is connected to the pipeline of a fluid gas A. So the pressure of the gas A is acting here, and here we have a water column, then mercury column. So here again we have the water column. The heights are given here. Look at the here. So we take, this is the datum. E to F is mercury level, and here we have the water level, and here again you have the water level. You have to find out the absolute pressure in this pipeline. So referring to this datum, E is the datum, taking E is the datum line. So the pressure PA, pressure acting PA equal to the pressure on the right side minus pressure on the left side. So G into rho W into 0.05. So rho W into 0.05 plus rho HG into 0.02 minus rho W into 0.17. So the total height is 10 plus 15 plus 2, 17. So for here the water column is 5 centimeter, here the mercury column is 2 centimeter. So G is 9.81. So substituting the value, 1000 into 0.05 plus 13600 into 0.02 minus 1000 into 0.17 equal to, G is taken as 9.81, 1491.2 newtons per meter square, or this is equal to 11.2 millimeter of mercury. Now the absolute pressure equal to, for absolute pressure, P atmosphere plus gauge pressure. So gauge pressure is 11.2. So 760 plus 11.2 equal to 771.2 millimeter of mercury. So the right answer is 771.2 millimeter of mercury. Reynolds number for a flow of a certain fluid is in a circular tube is specified as 2500. What will be the Reynolds number when the tube diameter is increased by 20% and fluid velocity is decreased by 40%, keeping the fluid is the same? And we define the Reynolds number. Reynolds number actually UD by nu. UD by nu. So here U is increased by, U velocity is decreased by 40%. So here nu velocity is 0.6 times of U. And the diameter is increased by 20%. So nu diameter is 1.2 times of D divided by nu equal to. So 0.6 into 1.2 into UD by nu. So UD by nu is the Reynolds number which is given as 2500. So 0.6 plus 1.2 into 2500 equal to 1800. So the answer is 1800. In a certain heat exchanger, both the fluid have identical mass flow rate, specific heat product, mass flow rate and specific heat product. The hot fluid enters at 75 degrees Celsius and leaves at 47 degrees Celsius. The cold fluid is entering at 26 degrees Celsius and leaving at 55 degrees Celsius. The effectiveness of heat exchanger. So, in the heat exchanger, so effectiveness is defined as actual heat transfer divided by the maximum possible heat transfer. Actual heat transfer, I take Cc into TCO minus TCI divided by C minimum. So, Cc is the heat capacity of the cold fluid. C minimum is the minimum heat capacity. So, C minimum into THI minus TCI. So, substituting TCO is 55 minus 26 divided by maximum temperature is 76, C minimum, THI is 76, TCI is 26 degree Celsius. So, the effectiveness is 0.58. Calculating the effectiveness is 0.58. The answer is 0.58. The following data pertain to a single stage impulse turbine, impulse steam turbine, nozzle angle is 20 degree. Blade velocity is 20 meters per second. Relative velocity at the entry is 350 meters per second. Blade angle at inlet is 30 degree. Blade angle at exit is 25 degree. If the blade friction is neglected, the work done per kg of the steam. So the correct answer is 124 kilojoules. So let us see how. So this is the velocity triangle, inlet velocity triangle, exit velocity triangle for the given steam turbine. Nozzle angle alpha equal 20 degree, blade velocity VB equal to 200 meters per second. Relative velocity is constant. Relative velocity is constant. VR1 equal to VR2 equal to 350 meters per second. Blade angle at inlet theta equal to 330 degree. Blade angle at exit phi equal to 25 degree. Now we calculate VW1. So VW1. So this total length equal to VR1 cos theta plus VB. So VW1 equal to VR1 cos theta equal to this length. VR1 cos theta equal to VW minus VB. So this is VR1 cos theta plus VB. So that 350 into cos 60 plus 20 equal to 503.1 meters per second. And VW2, so this length VW2 equal to VR2 cos phi minus VB. So 350 into cos 25 minus 200 equal to 117.2 meters per second. So the work done equal to VB into VW1 plus VW2. So 200 into 503.1 plus 117.2 equal to 124 kilojoules. So this is the work done. So that is what the answer we have marked here. So the answer is 124 kilojoules. Consider an actual regenerative Rankine cycle with one open feed water heater. For each kg of steam entering the turbine, if m kg of steam is with a specific enthalpy H1 is bled from the turbine and the specific enthalpy liquid water entering the heater is H2, then the H3 is a specific enthalpy of saturated liquid leaving the heater equal to what is value of H3. So this is the diagram. So we have a regenerative heater. The bleeding steam with the mkg with H1 enthalpy is entering the feed water heater. The steam from the condenser, so it is entering here, 1 minus mkg with enthalpy H2 is entering, liquid water is entering. So these two are mixed here and the saturated water leaves at enthalpy H3. So if mkg of steam, the specific enthalpy H1 is entering here and the specific enthalpy liquid water entering the heater is H2 and the saturated enthalpy, saturated liquid leaving the heater is H3. Now write in the energy balance. So total energy entering the heater is equal to total energy leaving the heater. So energy balance H3, energy leaving the heater equal to m into H1 plus 1 minus m into H2. So m into H1 plus H2 minus m into H2. So rearranging H3 equal to H2 minus m into H2 minus H1. The answer is C, H2 minus m into H2 minus H3. Consider a two-stage reciprocating air compressor with the perfect intercooler operating at the best intermediate pressure. Air enters at the low pressure cylinder at 1 bar 27 degrees Celsius and leaves the high pressure cylinder at 9 bar. Assume the index of compression and expansion in each stage is 1.4 R equal to 286.7 joules per kilogram Kelvin for air. Work done per kg of air in the high pressure cylinder. So we have to calculate the work done only for the high pressure cylinder. That is very important. Answer is 111 kilojoules. We will see how. So this is the two stage compressor. So the air enters here getting compressed in the low pressure compressor, leaves with the pressure P2 and it goes through an intercooler where the temperature is reduced to T3 and then it is going to the high pressure compressor, compressed and then it leaves with the pressure P4. So P3 equal to P2, the intermediate pressure, P3 equal to P2 equal to square root of P1 into P4, that is exit pressure into inlet pressure, 1 into 9, square root equal to 3. So the intermediate pressure here is 3. And the work done in the high pressure compressor W equal to N by N minus 1 MRT3 entry condition into P4 by P3 to the power N minus 1 by N minus 1. So P4 is 9, P3 equal to P2. So P3 equal to P2. So this T3 equal to T1. So for the perfect intercooling, the inlet temperature T1 is equal to T3. So substituting now, N by N minus 1, 1.4 divided by 1.4 minus 1, M equal to 1 kilogram and R equal to 0.2867 and T1 equal to 300 into 9 by 3 to the power 1.4 minus 1 divided by 1.4 minus 1 equal to 111 kilojoules. So that is what we have calculated, we have used here. The answer is 111 kilojoules. Next question. Clearance volume of a reciprocating compressor is 100 ml and the volume of the cylinder at the bottom dead center is 1 liter. The clearance ratio of the compressor is 1 by 11, 1 by 10, 1 by 9, 1 by 12. So, we calculate the clearance ratio. So, the clearance ratio equal to K equal to Vc by Vs. So, Vc is the clearance volume, Vs is the stroke volume or the swept volume. So, Vc is given as 100 milliliter, so which is 0.1 liter. And Vs is the swept volume or the cylinder stroke volume. So, it is 1 minus 0.1. Actually, we are given the cylinder, the volume of the cylinder at the bottom dead center. When the piston is at the bottom dead center, the total volume is clearance volume plus stroke volume. So, we have to calculate the stroke volume, which is 1 minus 0.1. So, the answer is 1 by 9. So, 1 by 9 is the answer. Then we have to match the table. So, look at the table. So, left hand side we have the steam nozzle, compressible flow, surface tension, heat conduction, and right hand side we have the Mach number, reaction turbine, Biot number, Nusselt number, super saturation, and Weber number. So, the matching steam nozzle, super saturation flow, that is the answer. Compressible flow, the Mach number. Surface tension, the Weber number. Heat conduction, the Biot number. Biot number is used in the lumped parameter method. So, transient heat conduction calculation. And now we have the part B problem questions. The first question, in a standard vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So, look at the word standard vapor compression refrigeration cycle. Operating between evaporator temperature of minus 10 degree Celsius and condenser temperature of 40 degree Celsius. The enthalpy of the refrigerant freon 12 at the end of compression is 220 kilojoules per kilogram. Show the cycle on the TS plane. Calculate A, COP of the cycle, B, refrigeration capacity and compressor power, assuming refrigerant flow rate is 1 kilograms per minute. You may use the extract of the freon 12 property table given below. So, temperature is given, pressure is given, HF, HG values are given. And this enthalpy at the end of the compression process, compressor outlet, we have the enthalpy. So, what is the cycle? It is standard refrigeration cycle, standard vapor compression cycle. So, this is the standard cycle. So, the standard cycle is the at the end and the one is the entry of the evaporator, two is the exit of the evaporator, 2 to 3 is the compression process, 3 to 4 is the condensation and 4 to 1 is the expansion. The standard cycle, a simple standard cycle is, this is the standard cycle. At the entry of the evaporator, at the entry of the compressor, it is saturated vapor. So, the given data, mass of the refrigerant is 1 kilograms per minute, which is 0.017 kilograms per second. Evaporator temperature, so here the temperature is minus 10 degree Celsius. Condenser temperature, so here the temperature is 40 degree Celsius. Now, from the table, we have to note down the enthalpy for all the points. So, specific enthalpy of refrigerant after compression, H3 equal to 220 kilojoules per kilogram. That is given in the problem. So, look at the value, 220 kilojoules per kilogram. Specific enthalpy of refrigerant after evaporation, 2, it is saturated vapor. So, H2 equal to HG2. So, from the table, you have to take minus 10 degree Celsius, HG2 is 183.1 kilojoules per kilogram. So, HG2 is 183.1 kilojoules per kilogram. And the specific enthalpy of refrigerant before evaporation. So, this is H1. So, H1 equal to H4. So, 1 to 4 is constant enthalpy throttling process. So, HF4. H4 equal to HF4 because 4 to point is saturated liquid. So, HF4 equal to 74.53 kilojoules per kilogram. So, look at the table again. So, this is 40 degree Celsius, HF equal to 74.53 kilojoules per kilogram. So, these are all the properties. So, H1 equal to H4, H2, H3. Then, coefficient of performance, COP equal to refrigeration effect divided by the compressor work. So, H2 minus H1 divided by H3 minus H2. So, refrigeration effect divided by the work input to the compressor. Substitute the numerical values 183.1 minus 74.53 divided by 220 minus 183.1. So, this is equal to 2.94. Refrigeration capacity RE equal to M into H2 minus H1. So, which is 0.017 into 183.1 minus 74.53 equal to 1.84 kilojoules per kilogram. And power required to drive the compressor P equal to M into H3 minus H2, which is 0.017 into 220 minus 183.1 equal to 0.63 kilowatts. In a certain double pipe heat exchanger, hot water flows at the rate of 5000 kilograms per hour and gets cooled from 95 degrees Celsius to 65 degrees Celsius. At the same time, 50,000 kilograms per hour of cooling water at 30 degrees Celsius enters the heat exchanger. The flow conditions are such that the overall heat transfer coefficient is 2270 watts per meter square Kelvin. Calculate area required and effectiveness of the heat exchanger. Assuming the two steams are in parallel flow, assume for both the steams Cp equal to 4.2 kilojoules per kilogram. And write down the given data. Mass flow rate is same. Mc equal to Mh equal to 50,000 kilograms per hour, which is 13.9 kilograms per second. Cpc equal to Cph equal to 4.2 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Thi equal to 95 degrees Celsius. Tho equal to 65 degrees Celsius. And Tci equal to 30 degrees Celsius. And the overall heat transfer coefficient is 2270 watts per meter square Kelvin. So, rate of heat transfer Q equal to MHCPH into THI minus THO. So, calculating subsidy value 13.9 and 4.2 into 95 minus 65 equal to 1751.4 kilojoules per second. And heat capacity CC equal to CH equal to M into CP. So, 13.9 into 4.2 equal to 58.38 kilojoules per Kelvin. Then the cooling water outlet temperature. So, TCO equal to TCI Q divided by CC, which is 30 plus 1751.4 divided by 58.38 equal to 60 degrees Celsius. And LMTD for parallel flow heat exchanger, logarithmic mean temperature difference for the parallel flow heat exchanger. So, the temperature difference at the inlet minus temperature difference at the outlet divided by logarithmic of temperature difference delta HI minus delta CI, THI minus TCI divided by THO minus TCO. Substituting all the numerical values, 95 minus 30 minus 65 minus 60 divided by logarithmic of 65 divided by 5. So, 95 minus 30 equal to 65, 65 minus 60 equal to 5. The answer is 23.4. So, heat transfer area A equal to Q by U into LMTD. So, 1751.4 into 1000 divided by 2270 into 23.4 equal to 32.97 meter square. And effectiveness equal to the actual heat transfer divided by the maximum possible heat transfer. So, which is THI minus THO divided by THI minus TCI. So, calculating 95 minus 65 divided by 95 minus 30 equal to 0.46. So, the answer to the question, heat transfer area is 32.97 meter square and effectiveness is 0.46. The power output of an IC engine is measured by a rope brake dynamometer. The diameter of the brake pulley is 700 millimeter and the rope diameter is 25 millimeter. The load on the tight side of the rope is 50 kg mass and the spring balance reads 50 Newton. The engine running at 900 revolutions per minute consumes a fuel of calorific value 44,000 kilojoules per kilogram at the rate of 4 kg per hour. Assume G equal to 9.8 meters per second square. Calculate the brake specific fuel consumption and brake thermal efficiency. And write down the given data. Diameter of the brake drum is 0.7 meter, diameter of the rope small d equal to 0.025 meter, weight equal to 50 kilogram and spring balance reading equal to 50 Newton, speed of the engine is 900 rpm, calorific value is 44,000 kilojoules per kilogram, mass of the fuel equal to 4 kilograms per hour and g, acceleration due to gravity equal to 9.8 meters per second square. The brake power for a rope brake dynamometer. So, the formula is W minus S, the load minus the spring balance reading into pi into small d plus capital D. So, diameter of the drum plus diameter of the rope into N divided by 60. So, the W is given in kilogram. So, 50 into 9.8 minus 50 into pi into 0.7 plus 0.025 into 900 divided by 60. The answer is 15024.9 watts or 15.0249 kilowatts. So, the power output of the engine is 15.0249 kilowatts. So, the brake specific fuel consumption BSFC equal to mass of the fuel divided by the brake power. So 4 divided by 15.0249 equal to 0.266 kilograms per kilowatt hour. And brake thermal efficiency, brake power divided by the mass of the fuel and the calorific value. So 15.0249 divided by 4 by 3600 into 44,000 equal to 0.307, which is 30.7%. So these are all the answers to the problem. So BSFC equal to 0.266 kilogram per kilowatt hour and the brake thermal efficiency is 30.7%. Next problem, at a place where the surroundings are at 1 bar and 27 degrees Celsius, a closed thermally insulated tank contains 2 kg of air at 2 bar and 27 degrees Celsius. This air is then churned for a while by a pedal wheel connected to an external motor. If it is given that the irreversibility of the process is 100 kilojoules, find the final temperature and the increase in availability of air. Assume for air, Cv equal to 0.718 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. So, the given data, surrounding pressure is 1 bar, surrounding temperature is 27 degrees Celsius, which is 300 Kelvin. Mass of the air inside the tank, insulated tank, is 2 kg. Initial pressure is 2 bar, final initial temperature is 27 degrees Celsius, which is equal to 300 Kelvin, and the irreversibility I equal to 1000 kilojoules, Cv equal to 0.718 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. The irreversibility of non-flow process, so this is a rigid container, so it is a non-flow process. For non-flow process, irreversibility I equal to To into delta S of the system plus delta S of the surrounding. So, for the, it is insulated, there is no heat transfer across the boundary. So, delta S surrounding equal to 0. So, Ti equal to 100, To equal to 300. So, delta S system. So, system entropy change is equal to 1 by 3. So, we have to remember this 1 by 3. Now, the change in entropy for a constant volume process, delta S equal to MCV into logarithmic of T2 by T1. So, this delta S we have calculated as 1 by 3 equal to 2 into 0.718 into logarithmic of T2 by 300. So, solving this equation, T2 equal to 378 Kelvin. Then we calculate the increase in availability of air, A2 minus A1 equal to U2 minus U1 plus PO into V2 minus V1 minus TO into S2 minus S1. So, here constant volume process V2 minus V1 equal to 0. So, U2 minus U1 equal to MCV into T2 minus T1 minus TO into S2 minus S1. So, substituting M equal to 2, CV equal to 0.718, T2 minus T1 equal to 378 minus 300 minus TO equal to 300, S2 minus S1 already we have calculated 1 by 3. So, solving the increase in availability is 12 kilojoules. The answer is 12 kilojoules. So, the increase in availability is 12 kilojoules and the temperature T2 equal to 378 Kelvin. In an air standard regenerative gas turbine cycle, the pressure ratio is 5. The air enters the compressor at 1 bar 300 Kelvin and leaves at 490 Kelvin. The maximum temperature in the cycle is 1000 Kelvin. Calculate the cycle efficiency given that the efficiency of the regenerator and adiabatic efficiency of turbine are each 80%. Assume for air, the ratio of specific heat is 1.4. Show the cycle on the TS diagram. So, this is the given data. So, pressure ratio P2 by P1 equal to 5, T1 equal to 300 Kelvin, T6 equal to, so this is the TS diagram. So, 1 to 2 isentropic compression, 2 to 3 heat addition the regenerator, 3 to 4 heat addition the combustor, 4 to 5 it is expansion of turbine, 4 to 5 isentropy expansion, 4 to 5 dash is the actual expansion. So, 5 dash to 6 it is regenerative. Regenerator, process in the regenerator, and 6 to 1, it is removal of heat, the cooling and return back to the original state. So, here what is given? P2 by P1 is given as 5, T1 is 300 Kelvin, T6 exit temperature is 490 Kelvin, maximum temperature is T4 equal to 1000 Kelvin, eta of the turbine and effect noise equal to 0.8, gamma equal to 1.4. And for the adiabatic process, so, 1 to 2, T2 by T1, 4 to 5, T4 by T5. So, T2 by T1 equal to T4 by T5 equal to P2 by P1 to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma, which is 5 to the power 1.4 minus 1 divided by 1.4 equal to 1.58. So, this is the for adiabatic process, adiabatic compression and adiabatic expansion. And already we have T2 by T1 equal to T4 by T5 equal to P2 by P1 to the power gamma minus into gamma equal to 1.58. So now T2 equal to 1.58 into T1, which is 1.58 into 300 equal to 474 Kelvin, and T5 equal to T4 by 1.58, which is 1000 divided by 1.58 equal to 632.9 Kelvin. And from turbine efficiency, eta equal to actual work divided by the isentropic work. So, substituting T4 minus T5 dash divided by T4 minus T5. So, substituting numerical value is 0.8 equal to 1000 minus T5 dash divided by 1000 minus 632.9. So, T5 dash equal to 706.3 Kelvin. And from the effectiveness of the regenerator, so effectiveness equal to actual heat transfer divided by the maximum possible heat transfer. So, T3 minus T2 divided by T5 dash minus T2. So, 0.8 equal to T3 minus 474 divided by 706.3 minus 474. Solving this equation, T3 equal to 659.8 Kelvin. So, we have calculated all the temperature T1, T2, T6. Now, once again, we take the cycle and the efficiency of the cycle, eta equal to WT minus WC divided by heat supply. So, T4 minus T5 dash, that is what the turbine work, minus T2 minus T1, that is the compressor work, divided by heat supply. T4 minus T3, substituting all the numerical values, 1000 minus 706.3 minus 474 minus 300 divided by 1000 minus 659.8 equal to 0.35, which is 35%. So, this is the temperature entropy diagram for the cycle and efficiency equal to 35%. Air enters a frictionless adiabatic converging nozzle at 100 bar 500 Kelvin with a negligible velocity. The discharge to a region, the discharger to a region at 2 bar. If the exit area of the nozzle is 2.5 cm square, find the flow rate of air through the nozzle. Assume for air Cp equal to 1005 and Cv equal to 718 joules per kilogram Kelvin. So, this is the nozzle, air nozzle. So, the given data P1 equal to 10 bar, T1 equal to 500 Kelvin, P2 equal to 2 bar, area is 2.5 cm square, Cp equal to 1005 joules per kilogram Kelvin and Cv equal to 718 joules per kilogram Kelvin. For air, the specific heat ratio Cp by Cv equal to 1005 divided by 718 equal to 1.4, R equal to Cp minus Cv equal to 1005 minus 718 equal to 287 joules per kilogram Kelvin. For adiabatic process, T2 by T1 equal to P2 by P1 to the power gamma minus 1 by gamma. So, 2 by 10, which is to the power 1.4 minus 1 divided by 1.4 equal to 0.63. So, T2 equal to 0.63 into 500 equal to 315 Kelvin. For a nozzle, the exit velocity is V2 equal to 2 square root of 2 into H1 minus H2. So, for air, H equal to Cp into T. So, 2 Cp into T1 minus T2. I take T1 outside. 2 Cp into T1 minus T1, 2 Cp into T1 into 1 minus T2 by T1, so equal to 2 into 1005 into 500, T2 by T1 already we have calculated as a 0.63, so 1 minus 0.63 equal to 609.8 meters per second, and density of the air, rho 2 equal to P2 by R into T2, which is equal to 2 into 10 power 5 divided by 287 into 315 equal to 2.21 kilograms per meter cube. The flow rate of air, M equal to A2 V2 by rho 2, so 2.5 into 10 power minus 4 into 609.8 divided by 2.21 equal to 0.06898 kilograms per second. A water turbine delivering 10 megawatt of power is to be tested with the help of geometrically similar 1:8 model, which runs at the same speed as the prototype. Find the power developed by the model, assuming the efficiency of the model and the prototype are equal. B, find the ratio of heads and the ratio of mass flow rate between the prototype and the model. So, the power of the prototype is 10 megawatt. The horizontal scale ratio is 8. So, horizontal scale ratio is the dimension, diameter of the prototype divided by diameter of the model, so which is equal to 8. That is 1:8 scale. So, the geometrical similar is 1:8 geometrical ratio. For the same speed of the model and the prototype, speed of the model divided by speed of the prototype equal to horizontal scale ratio divided by the square root of vertical scale ratio. So the vertical skill ratio, this is equal, nm equal to np for the same speed, nm equal to np equal to 1. So the sh equal to 8 divided by square root of sv. So sv equal to 64. So that is vertical skill ratio, which is the ratio of head of the prototype divided by the head of the model. So this is 64. Now the power of the model pm equal to pp divided by sh to the power sh square into sv to the power 3 by 2. So calculating 10,000 divided by 8 square into 64 to the power 1.5 equal to 0.305 kilowatts. The ratio of head and the ratio of mass flow rate between the prototype and the model. So already we have calculated. So sv equal to hp by hm. Head of the prototype divided by the head of the model equal to 64, and flow rate of the prototype divided by the flow rate of the model. So qp by qm equal to sh square. The answer is sh square into square root of sv equal to 8 square into square root of 64 equal to 512. So that is the answer. So power of the model is 0.305 kilowatts. The head ratio is 64. Mass flow rate ratio is 512. So this is the end of this 1997 question paper covering the 4 subjects. So thank you for watching. So if you have any comments or doubts, immediately after seeing the video, you can post on the comment box. So on the YouTube, there is a comment box. You can click it and type your comments on that. And subscribe the YouTube channel so that you will get all the updated videos on the GATE coaching. Also, I have uploaded thermal engineering, heat and mass transfer, all the subject, whatever mentioned in the first slide, all the for all the subject, I have uploaded video lectures in the YouTube, in the channel. So you can listen to it for your learning. And you can write to my mail ID, so, or you can WhatsApp to my number. I will sincerely answer all your queries. Thank you very much for watching. We'll meet again. All the best for your GATE examination.